I'd like to introduce Jack Hardy, first speaker.
Thank you, Diana. If you note in your program, that poem was written by Scotty Zielinski, who was active in this congregation, as well as the Valparaiso UU congregation. And I think it's a beautiful poem, so. Right, the poem was read at her memorial last month, that's where I got it, so. Okay, this morning, my talk is titled, To Swerve or Not to Swerve. To change or cause to change direction abruptly. Or, scientists might say, an unexpected, unpredicted movement of matter. But I'd like to leave that question for a little bit later in my talk. The first thing I want to talk about is the wonderful phenomenon of coincidence. We've all had coincidence in our life. It's when various elements come together, people, places, weather, circumstances, in a somewhat haphazard way, unplanned, and for a short window of time, they create the opportunity for change. Now, I want to talk about a specific coincidence that happened a long time ago, and I sprinkled it with lots of historical bits to keep you interested. So here we go. The year is 1417. The person is Poggio Rappellini. I guess I don't have to tell you he was Italian. So who was this character? Well, he was in his mid-30s. He was in southern Germany. He didn't speak any German. He was a very talented man, but he was unemployed. So how did that all happen? Well, Poggio had been a scriptor. And in the 1400s, there were approximately 100 scriptors working at the Vatican. And they were people who could read and write fluent in Latin. And they would write the papal doctrines and dispensations for the Pope, dispensations from canon law, where the wealthy could kind of get around the inconveniences of canon law. But Poggio was no ordinary scriptor. He was very talented. He was very fast. He was very accurate. And he had magnificently beautiful calligraphy skills. So he worked his way up to the top of his profession. And he ended up as the personal private secretary to the Pope. So who was the Pope that Poggio was working for? Well, his name was Baldassare Cosa. And Baldassare Cosa was a rather conniving, sly, sinister fellow. His family business in the coast of Naples, around Naples, had been piracy. And he was the cardinal of Bologna, and he had dinner with the Pope, Alexander V, on May 4th, 1410. And some say, by coincidence, the Pope died the next morning. And guess who became the new Pope? Baldassare Cosa. He took the name John Paul XXIII. Now, if you're as old as I am, you may remember John Paul XXIII, who became Pope in 1958, some 600 years later, 500 years later. So there's a reason why there were two Pope John XXIII's, which I'm going to come to in a minute. Now, why were they in Germany? Well, Poggio was following his employer, Pope John XXIII, to Germany. And the Pope had been asked, with very little room to refuse, to go to southern Germany. And that was quite a unique situation, because the Pope had power that would rival any king of any country in Europe. But the Pope had a problem. There were two other popes at the same time. It was the time of the schism in the Christian church. So let me back up a little and explain how that happened. Back in the year 1308, the Cardinal from Bordeaux, France, had been elected as Pope. And at that time, there were some warring and fighting going on with the city-states in Italy, so Rome was not the most secure city to live in. And with much urging from the French king, the new Pope decided that he would move the papal courts to the southeast city in France of Avignon in the Rhone Valley. Now, if you are wine drinkers and you've had Chateauneuf du Pape, that wine is from Avignon area, the Rhone Valley, and it literally means the new home of the Pope. So for the next 60 years, excuse me, the Pope lived and worked in Avignon, France. In 1377, the then Pope was influenced by Saint Catherine of Siena, and was persuaded to move the papal courts back to Vatican City in Rome, which he did. So the papal courts are now back in Rome, Vatican City, and a year later he passed away. So we all know the process. There's the conclave of cardinals to elect a new pope. And at that time, there were many Roman citizens that were concerned that a French pope would be elected and the papal courts would go back to France. So they made a lot of noise outside of the conclave, and they succeeded in getting or influencing the conclave to elect an Italian pope. Well, about 5 months later, the French faction of cardinals decided that this was not right and that they had been coerced into voting for an Italian pope. So they went ahead and elected a second pope, a French cardinal, who took up residency in Avignon. So we now have the beginning of the schism where we have two popes, one in Rome and one in France. And this lasted for about 30 years. It was an untenable situation, and nobody knew quite how they were going to resolve this problem. So finally they agreed, the powers that be, to come together in 1407 in Pisa for the Council of Pisa. The plan was that the two popes would attend, they would both resign, and they would elect the third pope. Well, what is planned is not always what happens. So neither pope attended and neither pope resigned, but they did manage to elect the third pope. So now we have a real problem. So about 8 or 9 years later, again the powers that be said, we have to come together and we have to resolve this problem. The Holy Roman Emperor at that time was the King of Hungary, and Pope John XXIII was in his debt because he had provided some security for Pope John XXIII. And so at his urging, the Pope agreed to attend this council to resolve the schism. Now, the King of Hungary also persuaded everyone that this meeting, this council, should be in Constance, on Lake Constance, which is also known as the Bodensee, which is a long horizontal lake at the bottom of the top of the Swiss Alps and the southern part border with Germany. And he did this because he felt that many of the elderly bishops and cardinals would not be able to cross the Alps to come to Rome. So we have the Council of Constance in about 1415, and Pope John XXIII was in attendance. And that's how Poggio went from Rome to southern Germany, not speaking any German. And how did he become unemployed? Well, with all these people here and trying to decide who's going to be the Pope, Pope John XXIII got a little bit nervous for his security. So one day he disguised himself and fled Constance, only to be captured a couple of days later. And that kind of turned the tide against him. And he was tried and convicted of 70 counts and imprisoned in the imperial prisons in Heidelberg. Several years later, he was burned at the stake for his sins, but at this time, he's in prison. And Poggio is now a very talented linguist. He's well-studied in ancient Latin, and he's unemployed. So instead of running right back to Italy, where he would eventually serve seven other popes as the papal secretary, he decided to indulge in his favorite hobby, and that was book hunting. Now, if you remember, at the time of Christ and a couple of centuries before, all the way through the 1500s, very few people could read and write. And manuscripts were written on scrolls of papyrus. And papyrus was made by the Egyptians from the plant papyrus. In the first and second century, the Europeans discovered a much more inexpensive way to create paper or paper-type substance, and that was parchment, which was made from animal skins. And the very finest documents were vellum, made from calf skin. Now, these documents could last, if they were taken care of very well, kept away from the bookworms that would feed on them and the humidity low, they would last between 400 and 500 years. And they had also switched from scrolls to the codex system of pages in books. So the keepers of these manuscripts and ancient manuscripts were the monks. They also required to read and write. And as these manuscripts would become frail and about to disintegrate, somebody's job was to copy them word for word and keep them turned over through the centuries. Now, one of the reasons Posio was excited about taking up his hobby was that about 80 years earlier, a book hunter had discovered a copy of a manuscript written by Cicero in Liège, Belgium. So he knew that there were monasteries out from the big cities in the countryside where these manuscripts were just sitting on shelves, slowly disintegrating. And he decided that his best shot would be a monastery in Fulda, southern Germany, because it had been a very prosperous Benedictine abbey previously, and in the last couple hundred years it had gone into decline, and so he thought that would be a great place to find some lost old manuscripts. So here's our coincidence. We have the right person, very talented calligrapher who could read the calligraphy, well-versed in ancient Roman writings, who would recognize anything of importance, in some far-off place in southern Germany, and he discovered a great work by Titus Lucretius Carus. Now, very little was known about Lucretius. He lived in the first century before Christ, which I'll refer to as BC, before the Christian Empire. There were references in history between the 4th and 9th century that Lucretius was a very extremely talented poet and well-versed in the use of the Latin language. There was a copy of a letter from Cicero that was written to his brother in 54 BCE, which stated, "The poetry of Lucretius is rich and brilliant genius, yet highly artistic." The historian St. Jerome, which lived in the 4th century, noted that Titus Lucretius was born in 94 BCE, but there were no writings or works in existence by Lucretius. They only knew of him. So Lucretius was, besides being a very talented poet, he was a great follower of the Greek philosopher Epicurus. And Epicurus had written hundreds of documents and manuscripts, but there were only copies of three letters known that Epicurus had written and 40 maxims of Epicurean philosophy. So very little was known about his thoughts as well. Some of the key points that Epicurus believed were, the purpose of philosophy is to attain a happy, tranquil life, peace and freedom from fear, and a big part of that was fear of death. He felt that the primary purpose of life was to seek pleasure and avoid pain. Now, the people who were detracted from Epicurus tried to make that out as someone who was very gluttonous with a lot of food and wine and sex and just total hedonist, but that's not the case. He believed that the key to attaining pleasure was through strong and meaningful friendship. He believed that death is the end of both the body and the soul. He felt that when your body dies, so does your soul. So this is it, no life after death. He believed that the gods do not reward or punish. Now remember, when he was writing this, there were Roman gods and Greek gods. The Jews had a single god, but Christ was not to be born for another 300 years. He felt the universe was infinite and eternal, and he felt that the events of the world are ultimately based on motions and interactions of atoms. The concept of atoms had been introduced 100 or 200 years earlier, but not the thoughts of how they interact and the purpose of atoms. So, an Epicurus used simple language. You didn't have to be a scientist or study science to understand what he was trying to say. All you had to know was that if something in nature, you experienced a drastic storm or influenza or something, all you had to know was it was based on the simple laws of nature, and then you didn't have to worry about offending the gods or worrying about if you're, you know, having a terrible afterlife. You could just relax and enjoy the fact that everything is in the beauty of nature. Epicurus was the first known thinker to systematically apply the concept of evolution to human culture, and he was the first to introduce the idea of scientific method, that you needed to observe things to prove your hypothesis to make it true. So, The poem that Lucretius found, or wrote, that Poggio found, is entitled De Rerum Natura. That's the best I can do in my Latin, but it means on the nature of things. And it was quite a poem. It was 7,400 lines long, and it was written in 6 volumes, so it was 6 books. Some of the key ideas in the poem are, everything is made of indivisible particles or atoms. They're indivisible, they're infinite in number, they bounce around and bounce off each other, they come together and create form or matter, and only to dissolve in back into atoms, only to come back as different forms and different things in our life. So he said that the atoms are infinite in number, but they're limited in shape and size, and they're kind of like letters in the alphabet. They're only one simple form, but because there are millions of them, and the way they come together, just like letters create words and sentences and ideas, these atoms create the infinite variety in the form of our world. He believed that the universe has no creator or designer. There was no divine intervention in creation of the world. And he believed that everything comes into being as a result of the swerve. Now, the swerve. He felt that if atoms came down from the sky under their own weight, just like rain coming straight down from the sky, that they would not come together and they would not create any form. But at totally unpredictable moments, there is the ever slightest swerve of direction which results in one atom hitting another atom, hitting another atom. The next thing you know, you've got atoms bouncing all over the place. And that's what creates the form and the matter of our world. And he went on to say that the swerve is what gives humans free will. He felt that the highest goal of human life is the enhancement of to enhance pleasure and to reduce pain. If it was painful, it meant you were in the wrong direction. And if it was pleasurable, then you could continue. And again, it wasn't self-indulgence. It was the pleasure of helping others and the pleasure of human relationship and friendship. He felt the greatest obstacle to pleasure is not pain, but delusion. Religion has done great harm to mankind whenever it has tended to exacerbate a fear of death, and then, in a vain attempt to lessen this artificially induced fear, to buttress the incredible and dangerous belief in individual immortality. So, now, and finally, he felt that if you accepted all these premises, then the most wonderful thing was that you could, this understanding of nature would give you a state of wonder. Again, just looking around at the infinite variety of form and life, and knowing that it was all of a natural order, and that you didn't have to fear the gods for doing something wrong, you could just simply relax and enjoy this beautiful world that we live in. Now, what are some of the implications of this find? Well, when Lucretius wrote this document, and it basically, it's thought that this was a poem to a friend to explain Epicurean philosophy. It was not, it was radical, but it was not dangerous. Remember, he wrote this in, the ideas came from the 3rd or 4th century BCE. And so we had no Christ. We had Roman gods, Greek gods, and the Jewish single god. And at the same time, we had Aristotle, who was a student of Plato, who introduced the concept that the world was made of 5 elements, earth, water, air, fire, and ether. And that the gods brought these elements together and created our world. And that would hold sway for about 1,500 years. So over time, the ideas of Epicurus written in the poem by Lucretius slowly fell by the wayside and were forgotten. In the early 4th century, after 3 centuries of religious pluralism with paganism, Judaism, and Christianity living side by side, Emperor Constantine made Christianity Rome's official language. And with that, the state embarked on the destruction of paganism and the strengthening of Christianity as the only real religion. Now, 1,500 years later, when this poem is introduced, and Poggio had a copy made and sent to Rome, and then many more copies were made, and 20 years later, Gutenberg discovered the movable press, so maybe 80 years later, we got this poem in print. So over the next century, it started to be disseminated to the educated class in Europe. It was a threat to the Christian church. If you didn't have a fear of God, you would have a fear of the Inquisition, because they would make sure you had a horrific death by not believing in the gospel. So, but it did trickle into society. Sir Thomas More, who was a counselor to King Henry VIII, was very fascinated with the poem, and he wrote a very famous manuscript entitled Utopia, where the term utopia was coined from, where he described what the perfect world would be. And he took a lot of ideas from Epicurus about seeking pleasure and happiness through human relations. But he was very careful not to get rid of the idea of divine intervention or life after death. He was such a devout Catholic, he did try to get the Inquisition into England without success. And as we know, he was executed because he didn't support King Henry VIII's request for an annulment of his marriage to Catherine from the Pope. There was a well-known, at the time, monk from Naples who fled Italy and went to England, and he wrote quite a bit, and he was in awe of the poem, The Nature of Things, and he wrote something that I think is incredible. He said, "It is thrilling to know that the grandest things are made of the smallest, and that we have the knowledge not to search for divinity removed from us, but that it is in us more than we ourselves." I think that's incredible. He made the mistake of returning to Italy. He was burned at the stake in 1660. I don't think I pronounced it right. Gordino Bruno. So it's wonderful to just pull all this stuff up on the internet and get instant answers. So on August 1st, 1632, the Society of Jesus strictly prohibited and condemned the doctrine of atoms. And a year later, our friend Galileo was sentenced to house arrest for the rest of his life for promoting Copernicus' idea that the Earth revolved around the Sun. So science was dangerous in those days.
But
still is. Yes, we're kind of going back there, aren't we? If you checked out what they're teaching in our schools these days. Anyway, Leonardo da Vinci, Shakespeare, Ben Jonson, whose copy of the poem is in the Harvard Library, Molière, Voltaire, Darwin, Isaac Newton were all influenced by the poem On the Nature of Things. Montaigne's essays contain over 100 quotes from the poem. And finally, our friend Thomas Jefferson, they found 5 copies of the poem in his libraries at Monticello, in addition to a translation in English, French, and Italian. And it was said to be one of his favorite books. And if you think back to the Declaration of Independence, where he says, "We know these truths to be certain inalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." So this book that was written in 50 BCE and was lost for 1400 years and by coincidence was rediscovered in 1417. Who knows where we would be today? I'm sure science would eventually have found where we are now, but who knows if it would have taken much longer. But we can clearly see there was influence from this work being reintroduced into society. So in closing, I just want to say one thing. I think that our lives are so busy and we're trying to get so much done and we don't ever have quite enough time to get through our day. And when you find yourself in the next couple weeks getting through your day and you've got a lot to do and you're on track and you're going to get everything done and you keep hitting every red light on the way to your appointment and somebody pulls in front of you that's going 20 miles an hour in a 35-mile-an-hour zone and you just miss that last parking place and you just think the world's working against you. And in that moment, just stop where you are and take a deep breath and think about what you see. Listen to what you hear, feel the air on your skin, and think, is the world trying to create some circumstances to bring some good in my life? And will I be too busy to recognize it? And then ask yourself, is this my time to swerve or not to swerve?